Juan, thank you so much for attending this digital workshop webinar organized by the French Chamber of Commerce and the French Tech Shanghai. Today's topic will be data-driven corporate culture. In these particular times, there is one thing that is certain, is nothing is certain. So why data-driven corporate culture is a must for companies to survive? What are the necessary steps to become data-driven and how to do it? These are some of the questions Stéphane Monsalier and Guillaume Mallet will answer today. Thank you, Stéphane. Thank you, Guillaume, for being with us. The mic is yours.
Thank you, Olivier. I would like to thank again CCI Francine and La French Tech for organizing this webinar on data-driven corporate culture. We are very happy to share our thoughts on the topic, and we hope you will enjoy this hour we're going to spend together. First, a few recommendations on how to improve your experience today. If you use, as you see on the screenshot, if you use the view option in Zoom, you can choose side by side, so the participant video will not hide any of the content. We will ask you also to please shut down all the applications that can pop up messages across your screen because that can be distracting. That includes Outlook, WeChat, and Skype. Please feel free to ask any question you want in the chat window, also accessible from the top menu. Olivier, our moderator for today, will organize the questions and will ask them during the last 20-25 minutes of our presentation. We will try to answer as many as we can in the time allocated today. So, data-driven corporate culture. In order to define it, I want to ask you to think about one question. What do you think is the opposite of a data-driven culture? We believe that the opposite is an expert-based culture, where knowledge is accumulated by humans throughout their experience based on what the world was 5 years, 10 years, or 20 years ago. The problem is that the world is changing at a faster pace and that we cannot afford to wait for 10 years to build our expertise. I believe that everybody here has experienced in the last few months things in the world that have completely changed, things that we cannot analyze with old models. So we need a faster, better culture than a culture that is based on experts. To cover this topic, first, we'll use a few stories to enlighten us on the fallibility of humans in making decisions and predictions. Then we'll look at why corporates want to become that data-driven. We'll look at the most common crimes committed against data, what is at the core of a data-driven culture, and finally, how to start this transformation. We're followed by a summary and our Q&A session. First, let's look at a story. The most renowned experts are the worst predicting the future. This is what Philip Teltow concluded from a long study on several hundred prominent experts in politics, science, and economy. He asked them to make predictions about the future, the way they were already doing it in the major US media at that time. The only difference is that he recorded those predictions and tested the outcome. The results of that study were slightly better than a coin toss, meaning 50-50. Half of the time the experts were right and half of the time they were wrong. And they were always finding that the prediction were worse than a basic extrapolation on the initial condition when they were making those predictions. But the most interesting finding of this study is that the most famous experts were less good at making predictions. Story number two. Intuition can lead to great outcome and great disaster. In his bestseller book, Blink, Malcolm Gladwell dissects intuition in various contexts, art curation, police shooting, or philharmonic orchestra recruitment. In those very different examples, he noticed a few patterns emerge on catastrophically wrong decisions. He noticed the inability of experts to assess new situations, and we know we are all in new situations today. And the problem with experts is they cannot identify the key differences between the usual situation and the new situation. He also noticed that the more data the expert asked for, the more they were likely to make the wrong intuitive decision. He correlated that with the confirmation bias that led experts to only retain the information that validates their initial instinct and discard the other type of information. And finally, Gladwell highlights that in a situation of crisis, protocol, processes, and procedures are often discarded, despite the fact that time of crisis are the time where they are most needed. Now, story number three. This is the story of Billy Bain. Yeah. And in that story, all the experts in the field turn out to be wrong, but nobody noticed until a great character changes that world forever. This is the world of baseball in USA. So Billy Bain started his career as a college baseball player, but he failed in his pro career. And he felt that the reason he was failing is that he was not in the right place. And the reason he was not in the right place was because of a selection process of the pro baseball at that time. And he thought there was a better way. So he became a talent scout himself for the Oakland A, and he later became the general manager for the Oakland A. And he demonstrated that everybody in the world of baseball was looking at the completely wrong metrics. And he proved it because the Oakland A had the lowest budget of the entire American baseball. And he was paying his players a third or a tenth of what the other clubs were paying. But they kept winning against those superstars because he was looking at the right metrics and he was looking at a baseball game with the correct analytic tools. Before we go further, we would like to know what are your expectations for today. So we're going to launch our first poll. So you will see a window pop up on your screen. And then please select the answer that you think is the most appropriate. So the reason why you want to join this webinar. That will help us to tailor a little bit the experience and get us to know you a little bit better, because in a webinar we can't see you. Yeah. So please, we're launching poll number one. You will see it on your screen. And please select the option that is best for you. So we'll give you a few minutes to click, to read and click. Okay. Okay, we're seeing the results. I will share them with you. A few more seconds. Okay, maybe some of you don't see the poll. That I know that happens in previous webinars. Okay, we'll give you another 5 seconds. Okay, 2, 1, 0. All right, so let's share the result. So it looks like most of you are interested in tips, how to become more data-driven, so we'll cover that. Understand what is a data-driven culture, we'll cover that. Start a data-driven transformation, we'll also cover that. So we're relieved to see that everything has been covered. Yeah, thank you. So now let's start. You have to put it back, sorry. So Guillaume, can you tell us why companies are looking into becoming data-driven?
So thanks, Stéphane. So in this section, yes, I will cover the reason why corporates make the choice of relying on decisions rather than relying on predictions. So let's go on. To begin with, let's have a look at the traditional way companies are making decisions. So everything starts at a given point in time where, based on the data they have available, a decision is made by a committee of experts. So this strategic decision leads to a series of planning decisions. What do we do? At which date do we want to have the desired results? And then responsibilities are shared within the organization. Then is the time for operational decisions. So which processes are going to change? Which tools are made available? And ideally, it will include data collection. Well-organized companies will do that. Eventually, only once all this decision-making process is completed, execution begins. And at that moment, data starts being collected to measure the expected results. Then controllers come and they analyze the results, again, the planning defined. If the results differ from the expectations, assumptions are then being made to explain why is it different. So based on these results, new decisions can be made. Are we going to start what we were, to start new things? Are we going to continue what we were doing? Or are we going to stop altogether what we were working on? So now that we have seen this traditional process, let's take a step back to what happens in this kind of process, looking at two cycles. First, what we see is that decisions, they are made on that data that was collected in the previous cycle with different objectives. In the end, decisions are not made on the actual data, but on the belief, on some kind of prediction of what the data will look like in the future. So it's not database decision, it's based on the future. Second, we can see that during the decision-making process, there is a blind zone. During this time, the time it takes to for the organization teams to reach a consensus, they may think that the data they are collecting is not relevant and disregard it. These are high-risk periods in a company because they are running not on data, but on faith that eventually the reality will match the prediction. So now the question is, are you doomed to make decisions relying on old data or no data at all? Or should you really make your decisions based on predictions? Because eventually, it's like doing fortune telling. So of course, the answer is no. Once a company culture is really data-driven, decisions are not based on predictions. So the first thing is data is collected continually. Of course, you may add different KPIs to your pool of monitored data. You may change a few things, but data is never, you never stop collecting data. There is no such a data gap as I was showing before. And when the time of making a decision comes, it is not based on a tentative of prediction. It is made on the certitude that relevant data will be available at any time in the future. So if we look at the chart which is on the screen right now, let's imagine that we are looking at sales turnover in a store for a product, for example. So if this piece of data is continuously available, when decision makers are elaborating scenarios and action plans for a range of possible outcomes. So they think, and at the moment they take the decision, they say, in scenario A, we are going to add more of this product in the store. In scenario B, where it's getting flat, maybe it's the time to start a promotion campaign, decrease the price. Scenario C, maybe we want to get rid of this product and bundle it with another one. And in this way, decisions are always made not on predictions, but on the actual data at the time where the action is taken. So that's one of the first benefits of being data-driven and benefit that we see in many of the successful e-commerce corporates, which are running their data, looking at the data all the time, and making their actions based on decisions that they took on scenarios. And that's one of the key to why companies are going data-driven and generate success. Another example is skills bottleneck. So here the question is, well, what would a city like Gotham City be without Batman? So here we know that we think that people are at the heart of every company, which is true, but we have experts, and these experts, they know how to react on dangerous situations that they met before. Even the best amongst them, they can tell and act before a dangerous situation even happened. These are heroes, but relying on heroes is a dangerous path. Accumulated experience is an asset that can quickly depreciate. Ask yourself, what happens when my hero is leaving the company? Is my hero able to share the knowledge he has? And then, how do I get more hero when I want to keep my company growing? So in a data-driven company, there are skilled people, and they trust each other, and they trust the data they receive. They are not heroes. They are working with discipline, and so they can replace each other in their position. That means when they need to grow their career, to move to another position, You don't have to ask yourself the question because you know someone else can take the position and fulfill the job. You don't rely on their accumulated experience. So in the end, defining good KPI data will and constantly measuring it brings benefit to the companies doing it. So now I'm going to leave Stéphane to explain us what are typical mistakes that are being made when trying to be data driven.
Yeah, except we don't call them mistakes, we call them crimes because they are too severe and we really think that the perpetrators deserve a harsh punishment. Every day in corporates, data are being treated badly. Abduction, torture, killing. For obvious reason, we have changed the names of the person involved in those real life examples. When Bob, the purchasing manager, hides the costs from the salespeople in the company, he prevents them from defending the margin and he puts them at a disadvantage from their competitors who know the cost and can better negotiate. When Kathy shares the sell-in data and she hides the sell-out data, she is rising production too early while the products are not even yet on the shelves of the retailer. By hiding the results of the job market study to managers, Amy, the human resource manager, have the managers negotiate raises for their team members in the dark, and the risk of losing the most skilled employees to the competition raises. So please try and catch yourself before you abduct data from a discussion, from a meeting, or from a report. You think you may conserve power by keeping the data by yourself, but you are actually weakening the entire organization. So this is what we call abduction of data. It removes critical insights at the organizational level. But that's not all. There are more crimes that are committed every day against data. Torture of data. Torturing data gives the illusion of being a data-driven company, but will always backfire. Yeah. So for example, when Liam, the CRM manager, is looking at a 3 months average of new follower, why is he looking at this? What happened when Lauren's boss asked her for a higher forecast? She's coming with numbers and he says, you have to make it 30% increase. You know. And why does ENA compare two consecutive months instead of a month-to-month comparison? What's hiding there? Liam probably changed the metric because the month-to-month comparison was not good. So he's looking at the 3 months average because it looks better in his reporting. Changing a metric because it looks better is the opposite of being data-driven. Yeah. In the case of Lauren and especially her boss, manager asking for better data without changing the underlying hypothesis are planning for failure. Actually, Lauren's boss is asking Lauren to lie to him, to present him what she doesn't believe into. And the final result next year will probably be closer to Lauren's initial prediction than to the line her boss is asking from her. And then Anna, she's looking at October and November, knowing that November includes the 11/11 sales. So the comparison, she's comparing actually apples and oranges. Yeah. So torturing data for the wrong reason leads to wrong decision and wrong outcome from the organization. But that's not all. There's also killing of data. Killing data prevents any chance of getting an accurate picture of a situation. You know. So when Liam, the CRM manager, is hiding part of the data and excluding it from the report, it's also to make it look better. But it doesn't reflect the true nature of the situation. When Kathy's his boss has a history of killing the messenger, the data presented to him will always be partial. He only wants to hear good stories. And this is an important part of a data-driven culture. The data is the data. If you want the person who presented to tell the truth and show you the entire situation, you cannot kill them for what is the reality. And finally, Sean, the e-commerce manager, he maybe want to simplify his reports, but it may miss important warnings in the future because he's removed product recall from his sales. You know. So in all these examples, we see why the data shouldn't be loaded with a point of view, with an opinion, with a filter, with an agenda. You know. data should be as pure and as transparent as possible and should be presented the way it is. Yeah. So I think you probably, we're going to send you another poll because we believe you may have noticed in your organization this kind of behavior. And we would like to know, now that we've given you those words or those concepts or those analogy, let's see in poll number two if you can recognize them and if you have noticed them in the recent past in your organization. So here comes the poll. Go ahead. Yeah. Can you launch the poll, please? Yeah. So it should appear on your screen. Now you know how it works. So have you noticed anything in the recent past, in the meeting with your boss or with one of your team member, or maybe another department? Okay. It happens every day. Don't be shy. The poll is anonymous anyway. Is it? I'm not sure, actually. But it's important. It's important to train yourself to see it, recognize it, and I would even push it further. It's important to stop yourself from making those mistakes, those crimes. You know? So we'll give you another couple of seconds to think about it. Think about yourself, your boss, your colleagues, other departments in the organization. Okay. You're actually being quite honest. almost equal. Ah, no, there's the winner. Yeah. Ah, yeah. Interesting. Okay, let's look at the result. Surprise. And the winner is intentional torture of data. This is very interesting. Yeah. I do believe that torturing the data is very, very common in corporates. That you get some numbers and you don't like them and then you change them. Now, I hope that now you see that this is dangerous and you have a better idea of why we want the data to stay what it is. And you want to look at the whole truth to make better decision and improve the data, because the data will change based on a reality that is changed thanks to the decision. But torturing the data to get to maybe another decision or influence the decision will not have the correct outcome. Yeah. So you can stop sharing the results. Thank you. And then give me back control on the presentation. Thank you. So Guillaume, now that we have pointed out why companies want to be and the crimes that needs to avoid, can you tell us the behavior that non-data driven company may have?
So I will show you the behavior of data-driven company through the example of sales and marketing. So first thing. Hello? Okay. So you missed it. So what I was saying, I'm going to show the what is a data-driven company through the example of a sales and marketing department. So first of all, first introduction, as a human being, you never need to think about breathing. Whatever the activity you are engaging in, it is so much of a priority to breathe air in and out that you don't even notice that you are doing it. Well, in a data-driven organization, collecting data, looking at data is exactly the same thing. Companies, we know that they need to stay in front of the trends, implement new tools, start new practice, try new technologies that appear every day, disrupt businesses, setting new standards for an industry, or if they don't do that, they quickly fade away from success. So teams, they need to make sure that they implement and they use them in the right way to make sure their consumers are staying with them. But the question here is how many teams are really ready to make the most of the data this tool will generate. So first of all, when a new project comes, most teams will think that integrating it with other tools to get data, it's getting in the way. It's kind of okay for a pilot project to not collect data or collect very few data and not look at it, or even think that the data which is collected is not accurate. That's a trap. in the end, when you want to start a new project, start a new experiment, you need to prove success. And the best way to prove success of a project is to collect data and compare this data with what is usually collected in the company. Compare it with the data everybody is breathing in and out of that. Here we see that for them, not collecting data should become the same as stopping breathing. Nobody would think that stopping to breathe would bring you an advantage, right? It's the same for collecting data, and that's the reason these departments are going this way. So the question that will come after that is, okay, how do I start breathing data? And how do I make collecting data as simple as breathing? Well, the answer to this question is to try and keep things very simple since the beginning. So being data-driven means agreeing on what is the data collected at any time a project starts. So here I'm taking the example of a simple data model that we built and we used for one of our customers in the past. And building this simple data model, we focused really on three different types of data. We were collecting data on the individuals, so that persons that are interacting with your brand at least once, and we collect very simple information about them. We were collecting data about transactions. Every time the customer is spending money with you or generated revenue or cost for you. And then we were also collecting interactions. So when a customer is talking to someone in your store, interacting in your website, looking at something that you have available, and you are able to collect the data. Here, the very important point with this data model is that we didn't make it mandatory that when there is an interaction recorded, it's necessary we can identify the individual. And that's a very important point. To be able to collect the data in a simple way, the constraint has to be as little as possible. You want to be able to count the interactions. You don't want to be able to link them to individuals. So the point here is don't listen to people telling you that IT systems don't work this way. You need to be consistent. You need to catch an individual. It's not like that it's working. No, the target is when a project starts, collect the data and be able to look at it. The data may seem very simple here, but with these three simple models, there is a lot of things that you can already calculate and know about your business. You can know from the transactions, you can know your total revenue. From the individual table, you can know how many persons are interacting with your brand and know you as a brand itself. And through interactions, you can know the success of your communication campaigns. So these models help to collect the data. And then going back to the topic I was explaining earlier, it's now very practical to apply it to sales and marketing. The objective normally of launching a marketing campaign should never be to collect more data to be able to make decisions or to get more followers so we know our customer better. If you do that, you are again trying to predict the future. A data-driven team continuously collect data and measure KPIs in all situations. Therefore, campaigns can be planned to be triggered on particular events and scenarios that can be planned within campaigns. So this is, for example, the way websites like Cdiscount in France are working. They look at their data every midday and they adjust the promotions that they are making in the afternoon. So if all campaigns are feeding data and if the people in the team are confident and they trust that data will continuously be available, then they can make sure that whatever happens, they have a scenario ready and they know how to react on it. And that's the power of creating this kind of feedback loops and knowing what to do when a particular event happens. So you don't make your campaigns to collect the data. You make your campaigns and you plan your campaign so you can act on the data in the future. And that's the way a sales and marketing team would work when it is data driven. So now, Stéphane, can you tell us what is the first thing to do when the company is becoming data driven?
Yes, Guillaume, I'll explain that. But I have to tell you first, it's not easy. If it were easy, all the companies would be basing their decision on the information they had, and they will all have data driven within their DNA. Before we move on, I would like to send the third poll to know a little bit more who is on the call and especially where you sit in the corporate hierarchy. That will help me to give you information that is more more relevant to you. So if we can sell the poll number three. This one should take you half a second, so please launch it. Should take you half a second to find yourself and reply. It's not a difficult question. Basically, where do you sit in the hierarchy in your organization? Okay. All right. Then we see, we'll see the balance. We see more or less who's here. Okay, where do you sit in your organization? Okay. Interesting that the top of the organization is faster to reply than the rest of the organization. Okay, I think that gives us a good overview. So even if not everybody replies, so please end the poll. We can share the results. So we have a lot of C-level and directors in the room. That's good, because I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to send you a very strong message. Yeah. So I hope we have participated today to raise the awareness that will make it difficult to start or continue your journey to become a more data-driven organization. You know, so this is the first step of raising awareness. And then I'm very happy that we have a lot of C-level and directors, because I'm going to tell you that it's going to start with you. Yeah? And after, this is the way you're going to infuse a strong sense of ownership throughout your organization here in China. Yeah. So to make it clear what's in it for employees, we'll make a better awareness campaign. You know, motivate your team, motivate employees to change. You have to use what coaches are using usually. What will happen if we don't change? You know, few employees will want to make bad decisions. Actually, none of them will want to make a bad decision. But in a non-data-driven organization, they will be led to make wrong decisions. Intentionally or accidentally, they will have to bear that burden. You know. For every position that you have in your organization, there is already a better, more efficient version of this job being performed by somebody else in another organization that is more data-driven. You know. So for your employees, for the team members, for everybody to still be relevant on the market, they have to continuously move in that direction of being more data-driven, because other companies are doing it. You know. So raising awareness, you can point out to your employees. Losing ground to the competition is bad news for managers, bad news for directors, but it's also bad news for employees. Because if your company is seen on the market as not being as efficient as others, you won't find a job in another company. So again, this is a way that you can raise awareness, and this is a way you can tell your employees that they have to be on board, and they have to get the skills, and they have to change their behavior. And something that I truly believe in, something we've seen in our company, being data-driven frees up a lot of time, and it reduces a lot of stress. You know, when employees don't have to crunch the number manually, when they don't have to try and guess what the future will be, but they will rely on the data that is there, that is available, and information that is confirmed, they will not worry too much. You know, so this is how you can raise awareness in your teams, and these are the four elements that maybe one or two of them will resonate with your team if you want to bring them. Now, and I'm talking to you, C-level and directors, it must start with you. Yeah. And for the others, you need to convince your CEO, your director to think about it. Yeah. So it has to start at the top. If it doesn't start at the top of an organization, my advice is don't stop. So is your CEO, your general manager, or are you yourself data-driven? And how do you know? What does a data-driven general manager look like? What type of question you should expect from a manager, from a director that is data-driven? What is their management style? And what is their KPI? So me as a CEO of System in Motion, when we decided to implement a KPI system entirely and all bonus to that KPI, the first thing I did was establish my KPI as a CEO. and tie my bonus to those KPIs that are completely open and measure and that all the management team can see. After I've done that, it was obvious that every employee in the company would follow. Yeah. So when there's when you have a data-driven general manager, a director at the top of a department or the top of an organization, everything becomes easier. Because a GM will not tolerate a CMO or CFO that is not data-driven. So the organization will fall in line behind that leader. So think about Jeff Bezos, for example, the CEO of Amazon. Do you think he's obsessed with data? Do you think that he could hire somebody who are not? And what do you think about Jack Ma? Is he obsessed with data? Is he measuring? Does he want to measure everything? And does he hold his whole management team and everybody in the organization to rely that decision on information? This is, for me, the reason why those companies are so successful. Because, again, it starts at the top and it has to start at the top. Yeah. So finally, a third element really important to start. Every employee must take ownership of their data. This is the only way the transformation can be successful. In his book, What Gets You Here Won't Get You There, Marshall Goldsmith explained that the easiest way to change a behavior is not to try and learn a new habit, because it's very, very difficult. The easiest way is to stop bad habits. So the same goes here. To instill a sense of ownership of data, there are a few sentences to eliminate from all your meetings and all your discussion. Here are a few examples. The system has the wrong data. That doesn't bring a sense of ownership and accountability. The report is wrong. The numbers don't add up. I didn't get the data in time. So if you're here is in this meeting, you need to stop that. You need to stop the person who is saying that sentence. And you definitely need to stop yourself. So I trust that list that I gave it to you, you can probably go on and add a few more there. So data ownership, a sense of ownership, implies that there is no blame in the data or the system. The data owners must know their data, ensure its quality, and protect them from the various crimes that we have discussed earlier and that could be committed against them. Yeah. So as a data-driven culture has to replace an expert-based culture, to ensure fast and dynamic decision-making, protect your data, and make data management as natural as breathing, you have to stop that movement at the top and instill a sense of ownership. Yeah. So this data-driven corporate culture journey that we talked about, it requires to collect more data. You have to increase its quality. You have to implement the right systems in your information system. You need the right processes. You have to break the silos. You have to be better at analyzing. All of these are necessary to continue or accelerate that path of becoming more data-driven. But this is not enough. There is something more that you need to do and something that is deeper. It also requires to start at the top. Otherwise, don't bother. Everything that matters must be measured. If you don't measure it, it does not exist. Having data to support decision is non-negotiable. Shortening the feedback loop is critical to avoid getting surprised by rapid change on the market. We've all seen a lot of rapid changes in the past weeks, and I don't think it's going to stop. Opening data access to everybody is necessary to create transparency that leads to trust and the development of a strong sense of ownership in your organization. These are as important, if not more important, than what you thought about and what probably we had in the previous slide. All these elements, you need to check them out. You know. So we've been talking for a while now. I guess there are some questions that are coming through that came out through the chat. If you have questions, if you didn't ask them, please come out. So, are there any common obstacles of creating non-data-driven corporate culture for foreign entities in China? I don't think there are, personally, I don't think there are more obstacles in China than anywhere else in the world. I think to me, to me, maybe the opposite. There's a lot of data. There are a lot of platforms. There are a lot of ways to find data and to aggregate data in China. I think they are there. They are out there, and if you start looking for them, you will find them. And if you base your decision on data you can collect, you will also identify the data that is missing. And then you will look for these pieces of information. You go and get them, and you will improve your decision process through those loops. But I don't see any reason why it would be different in China and why it would be different for a foreign entity. Do you have any example in mind or counter example?
One example I can give, but I'm not sure if it's typical to China or not. But the most common, not say mistake, but attitude I've seen towards data in China, which was creating a challenge, is how to react when you see two visions of the same piece of data. We'll take a simple example, which happens all the time. It's stock view. For companies which are working with stock, I think it's a case you've seen. If you look at, let's say, your stock in your financial software and your stock in your warehouse software, you're going to find that they are never the same two numbers, which is normal because the financial software is there for giving you a piece of a point in time vision of the stock so you can calculate your assets, and the warehouse software is there to tell you what you can deliver to your customers. But I've seen in a lot of cases people which were looking at that fact and thinking, oh my God, the data is not good, what can I do? And stopping acting on that. And being afraid of, okay, I don't see the two same numbers, so they must both be wrong. Actually, they are both true. And it's a difficult fact to admit, but it's something that I've seen people looking at that and thinking, oh my God, we are blocked. Don't be blocked, continue looking at the right data and act on the way it evolves. But the key point there is trusting the data and being able to rely on it. I think it's the most common thing I've seen. I don't think it's typical to China, though.
Probably not. Yeah, probably not typical to China. Another question. In the context of crisis, what are the key elements to take into account for a company to become data-driven? Is there a particular behavior and practices to avoid in regards to COVID-19 crisis? So I'm going to express my personal opinion. My personal opinion in the time we are, and it's very consistent with what you said, Guillaume, is to stop making predictions. You know, we've seen things, just to take an example, a couple of days ago, the future on oil became negative. Nobody could predict that. Nobody had any idea it will arrive, and nobody has the model, and nobody knows what to do with it. You know, and I'm sure you also had examples of this in your organization. So instead of trying to predict the future and redo your budget every week and spend a lot of time and a lot of energy into, okay, what are we going to do? What do you think is happening for sales? As Guillaume explained very elegantly, we need to be in reactive mode. We need to make sure the data that we're collecting is correct. Maybe we need to look for additional data that we don't have and that we're not looking at. And we need to react fast. This is another point that the crisis has taught us. We have to react fast, and corporates can react fast. I'm going to give you another example. I'm pretty sure that if a CEO went to his CIO in November 2019 and asked the CIO, how long will it take to implement remote work for all the company in China? The answer would probably have been 12 to 15 months and a 3 or 10 million RMB budget. Now, in February, we all know what happened. It happened in 3 days, and the budget were not, and it didn't cost that much for the companies. You know, so these decisions, so we are seeing that things that we believe were long and expensive can actually be short if we make the right decision and if we have correct data to support them. So I hope I answered that question. Actually, it's really my opinion. It's really what I've seen in talking to all our clients and all companies and entrepreneurs here in China and in Shanghai particularly. I'm seeing that as becoming truer and truer. Yeah. Can you elaborate a little bit more about develop a strong sense of data ownership? So I guess that data ownership somehow is the opposite of what a lot of companies are doing, which is hire a data team. So they hire a data team with data scientists, data engineers, data, a lot of data job descriptions, and then they put them in the corner of a company. And when you do this in a corporate, suddenly they are the data guy and the data is their problem. If it's right, it's their problem. If it's wrong, it's their problem. So this is the opposite of what we think should happen, where the sales department have to be in charge of the sales data. It belongs to them. If it's wrong, they need to be the first one to know that it's wrong. They need to know their data so well that anything that happens, they should see it. They should feel it. This is one thing that is in Moneyball, the book about baseball. There's one sentence there, it's very long, I can't quote it. But basically it says that when you can read the data, it tells you a story. What is that story? You know. So again, in sales, the sales department needs to know their data and the sales data need to speak to them. In the HR department, they need to know their data. It has to speak to them and they can make decisions. They know when it's wrong, they know how to fix it. Yeah. So this is what we mean by a strong sense of data ownership. You know. While we continue, can you give me control on the PPT? Yeah. Because I see the yeah. Okay, one more. Yeah. So I see there are questions and I'm pretty sure we won't get to the end. So here you have two QR codes. These are my LinkedIn on the right side and Guillaume's LinkedIn on the left side. So feel free to connect to us on LinkedIn. And then we can continue that discussion afterwards. Yeah. So can we see the question again? So next question, how to regain control over the data? Interesting one, right? So it's, yeah. I mean, if you were there in front of me, I would ask you, how did you lose control of your data? You know, well, it's a bit difficult to comment on this one. One thing for sure is regain control of your data and don't give up. This is something that we see quite often. We see, for example, in the retail business, we see major brands letting either their agency, the platforms, keep those data for themselves and they don't demand those data. And they let it go out. They let data being generated about their brands, about their customers, about transactions, about products, and they sit outside of the corporate. You know, so I don't know how, because I don't know your business and I don't know what you're doing. So I cannot give you advice like this without asking you a ton of questions. But what I can tell you is don't give up, don't stop. If it's your data or you believe it should be your data, it has to be your data. You have to get control of it. Now, I don't know your situation, so I can't give you advice.
Yeah, I think it relates to the part where I was explaining about breathing. If you feel that you lost control over the data, yeah, claim it back. Go back to the partner, go back to the supplier which took the data away and say, okay, we have a tool. We want to receive a simple piece of data. Don't make it complicated. But in the end, that's the way to get back the data that you should get back. So you should have within your company. So after, the first step of that is to define what is the data that you cannot compromise with. To know, okay, what is the numbers you always want to be looking at and the numbers you will, whatever comes, refuse to go on, refuse to work if you don't have it available. I think it's maybe the first very healthy step to take is to say, okay, we are, whatever we do, we are looking at turnover, we are looking at numbers of followers, and we are not giving up to getting that data. Make it clear since the beginning and you will keep control of it.
Make it non-negotiable. You know, so if you think it's too late and data is gone, you make it non-negotiable. Whatever supplier you sign with, whenever you renew your contract, data has to be part of it and you have to own it and you have to control it. Now, there's another side. Maybe I can read your question in another way. So maybe it's not data that has escaped you, but maybe it's data that is that you don't control internally. So it could be also a data quality problem. I could read that sentence also in that direction. So in that case, the answer is the same as before. It's ownership. You know, you need to assign ownership to every aspect of your information system, and then departments have to go and they need a plan to go and recontrol this data internally, make sure that it's accurate. Data quality is a big problem. We didn't talk about it today, but it's also something that you have to do. And but without data ownership, you will it will be very difficult to get to the data quality. No. So I see there's another question. There's one more under. Can you scroll? Can you show us the question? Okay. When a corporate wants to shift to an artificial intelligence oriented model, what are the steps needed? It should acquire connect with external databases. So artificial intelligence, that's a very good one. Basically how to go into artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is all about data. You can talk to any artificial intelligence expert, any data scientist, they will all tell you the same thing. If you want to build an artificial intelligence model, you need high quality information, you need high quality data. So my advice is, before you go and develop artificial intelligence, you need to apply everything that we said today. Otherwise, it's not gonna... Okay. Looks like we have technical issues. Okay. So can they hear us now or not? Okay. So sounds like I need to rewind. So the question was, how do you start to implement artificial intelligence? So if you talk to artificial intelligence experts or data scientists, they will all tell you the same thing. Artificial intelligence feeds on data. So what if you want to go in the artificial intelligence route, you need to do basically everything we've been talking about today. You need to have clean data, you need to have data ownership, and you need to base your decision based on your data. Now, artificial intelligence is only a tool. So it's one tool in all the IT toolbox. And before you implement artificial intelligence, so let's say it's a very advanced tool. It's a very... it's like in the hierarchy of tools, it kind of sits at the top in decision making and predictive analytics, right? So before you go there, you have to go through the steps. So before you implement artificial intelligence, you have to be data driven first. One thing, there was a very interesting article in the Harvard Business Review about predictive analytics. It was written a few years back, and the author said the biggest problem with big data is that people don't understand how it works, so they don't apply the result. And this is very true in a lot of organizations. You do an intelligence artificial project, you have a very complicated model that has been designed by very smart people, and then the team ignore the results, and they rely back to their expertise and the way they've been doing things intuitively in the past. Why is this? Because of everything we've been talking about today. Because they don't have a data trust culture, because they don't trust the information, and because the model is probably too complex. So before you go and run, you have to learn how to crawl and you have to learn how to walk. So there are steps to go through. They are being accelerated so you can go through these steps faster and faster. But you cannot go from no data or poor data directly to artificial intelligence. I had discussion with a few artificial intelligence experts and I asked them one question. How many of artificial intelligence proof of concept go to production? The honest one told me 40%. So 40% of those projects don't go to production. What is the number one reason why they don't go to production? Because the data is not available. To build a successful machine learning model, they need data that is just not there. So for the proof of concept, they go and grab the data and they clean it and they go and they bring it back. And then it works on past data, but that all that work of data cleaning, of data collection, of going and grabbing the data is not there. As Guillaume explained, you need to collect those data continuously and you need to have all the data available all the time. Until you get there, don't try to plug in a machine learning model there, or it's not gonna work. Yeah. So we wouldn't be data-driven ourselves if we didn't collect feedback from this meeting. So please, if you can give me control again to the PPT. Yeah. So we would like, Yeah. So would you please scan this QR code to complete the survey? Tell us how we did today. Basically give us information, you know. So scan that QR code. It will take 2 minutes to complete that survey. And it will give us more information to improve it in the future. Again, if you want to continue the conversation, we gave you our LinkedIn, or you can probably find us by names. Our names are not that common. They can't see the QR code anymore. Can you put it back? Okay. So I would like to thank again CCI Franchine, La French Tech, for hosting us today. I hope you enjoy the show. We will try to put back the QR code if you didn't have time to scan it. We will be very happy to hear and get your feedback through the survey. And again, very happy to continue the conversation. Yeah. Thank you, Guillaume. Thank you, Olivier.
Stéphane, thank you, Guillaume. And stay tuned for the next webinar from French Chamber of Commerce and French Tech Shanghai.